Good evening. This is Ryan Will, and I'm here with Mr. Whistler. And you have joined us at the 2015 International WFTDA Division II Playoffs here in Cleveland, Ohio. We are very pleased to be bringing you a medal round, the 3-4 game between Santa Cruz and Houston.
That is indeed correct, Ryan. We will be seeing Houston Roller Derby's Houston All-Stars. They are taking on the Santa Cruz Derby Girls Boardwalk Bombshells. Houston, of course, from Houston, Texas, currently ranked at number 53 in the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. Santa Cruz, of course, hailing from Santa Cruz, California, go figure. They are currently ranked number 42. They are the number one seed here at Cleveland, Ohio.
So we'll take a moment to let you know who exactly is going to be playing in this game momentarily. On the side of Houston, number 11, Poisonberry Pie. Number 16 is Miss Stilla. Number 19, Betty Watchett. 21 is Jekyll and Heidi, also the captain. 26, Brandy Brown. Number 3, Speedo. 31 is 2x4. 51, Bustin Beaver. Number 6 is Hellcat F6F. Number 7 is Kelly Kilpowski. 751, Hot Assets. Number 9 is Big Bad Voodoo Dolly. 91, Slayer Moon. And 96, Patty Payne's. On the bench, they have Carl Schultz.
And the roster for this game for the Santa Cruz Derby Girls Boardwalk Bombshells, they will be wearing black. Their roster is 0018, Jem Jones, 116, Terraism, 13, Chelsea Smile, 1384, Heloise, 23, Corazon, 24, Beans, 4 is Health Hazard, 41, Queen Litigious, 444, Unleashed, 514, Victoria Mayhem, 667, Roasted Pony, number 8, the captain for this game, Shamrock and Roller, 86 is Heartless Harpy, and Ice 9, Skirt Vonnegut. Working the bench for Santa Cruz is Valkahol.
On the skates out there in the black and white, trying to keep it exactly that, you will have as your crew head ref, Mattis Faction. Inside is Laddie. Your jam referees are Julius Seizure and Professor Murder. On the outside of the pack, Jules and Regulations, Freddie Mercenary, Zadork, and Cleveland, appropriately, sitting right next to us here in Cleveland.
Go. I love how that all comes together. It's like this was deliberate.
It's like it was made.
If you've been watching all weekend, and if you're watching right now, please check in with us using the hashtag on Twitter, #TalkToWFTDA. We want to know what you think about this game, the entire weekend. This is the third all-time sanctioned meeting between these two teams. Lifetime, they've each taken a win. The victory for Santa Cruz was earlier this year in June. The victory that went to Houston was actually 3 years ago tomorrow.
Anniversaries are abounding this weekend. That's quite phenomenal. We've been able to get a lot of updates throughout our weekend. Again, this is our 10th anniversary, and we appreciate all of the love and support from our original 20 leagues at the formation of the WFTDA to just about 400 now. Very remarkable outpouring of love that we've had here this entire weekend.
So leading off on the Fast Girls start line for Houston will be number 91, Slayer Moon, and for Santa Cruz, number 41, Queen Litigious.
So as we see Slayer Moon trying to take the outside lane, as decides instead to go right up the middle. She's got a two-wall and then another two-wall to deal with. As she pulls herself back, Queen Litigious takes from the outside through the inside to become lead jammer right around turn number two. We see Slayer Moon doing about the same positioning there, but unfortunately half a track behind as Queen Litigious now looking to score points.
As the skaters in the pack are rounding turns 3 to 4. Lots of back and forth action happening in there. Nobody really able to take a front wall. And we do get 2 points coming in for Santa Cruz on that first jam, Ryan.
Yeah, I think we're going to see a lot of, not that we haven't this weekend, let me state that, a lot of smart play in this game. I think we're going to see a lot of strategy employed. And, you know, great, it's a medal round, but you always want to go out in that third. You always want to come in and get as close as you can, obviously. But I think we're going to see fast play like we've seen and smart play like we've seen, indicative of this game already so far. Santa Cruz has 2, Houston has 0.
On the Fast Girls start line for Houston, number 26, Brandy Brown. And for Santa Cruz, number 116, Terraism.
Brandy Brown looking to see if she can get past the two wall. She was able to do so as she was able to push them to 20 feet. She is the lead jammer, though unfortunately, we're seeing our jammer come back around. I had gotten that completely wrong. That was Terraism. I'm giving credit to the wrong person. Terraism was making that push. It was Brandy Brown coming through. That's why I had to stop for a moment. You know, like I say, the action is that good, I couldn't even keep track of who it was. So as we come back to it, Santa Cruz, 2 more points. That's going to take them to 4 points. Houston still at 0.
Fast Girl Skates, our mission is educating skaters. Get schooled. FastGirlSkates.com.
Jammer Freeze at the back line having a quick conversation as they're waiting for the 5 seconds.
On the Fast Girls start line, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly for Houston in white. Corazon, number 23 for Santa Cruz in black.
Voodoo, as I've been told she prefers to be called, getting knocked to the interior. She has to reset herself right at the correct straightaway, but all the way across the track. On the other side, we have a lead jammer. That for Santa Cruz is Corazon as she comes around now, turn number one, looking to see where she will find points in the pack.
Yeah, Houston looking to set up at the back. Their four wall gets divided into a pair of twoses. And that's going to allow Corazon to get through for a couple more points. Looks like she's picked up two on that pass, but Houston on the board with their first point of the game.
It was interesting as we'd been talking about looking at the swing of the teams. We definitely have Santa Cruz on that kind of downward swing, a little bit of a dip up at the end, but we have a consistent similar with Houston. They're just kind of riding that wave to the point that they're at right now, doing very well coming into this weekend. As you had said earlier, number 91, Slayer Moon, Houston, going to be jamming up against Roasted Pony, number 667 for Santa Cruz in the black, who currently is trying to take the interior lane, but is not having any luck with that as she hits that three wall. Nice little bit of a brace triangle. Number 31 getting a good piece of her on that interior 2x4s. Not going to give her much movement with the wonderful assistance happening there. A little bit of a split difference, looking to see with the jammer toward the front of the group. That is going to be number 91, Slayer Moon, who is able to get out, and she's your lead jammer.
Yeah, got a little bit of offensive help there from number three, her pivot, Speedo, split off from the pack to create a disturbance in that force. Roasted Pony also clearing the pack on her initial pass for Santa Cruz.
And number 51, Bustin' Bieber, pays the price. Beautiful blocking, but unfortunately it was considered a multiplayer block. She just held a little too tight for a little too long. She is going to be sent to the penalty box right now. Update of our score, Houston is on the board at 5. Santa Cruz holds 1 point above at 6.
Each team with a blocker in that derbysupply.net penalty box. So on the Fast Girls start line, we have number 26, Brandy Brown for Houston. And it's going to be number 41, Queen Litigious for Santa Cruz.
Both jammers starting from a low central point. Both getting pushed to the outside. Queen Litigious behind goes all the way, having to recycle. Brandy Brown, number 26 in the white, able to do a little bit more damage moving forward through the pack because she was not most toward the interior. She does have the benefit of that. She's able to push through. She becomes the lead jammer. And once again, unfortunately for Queen Litigious, she has been recycled again through the middle.
Yeah, heavy recycling happening here. And Queen Litigious looking for that opening, going to try to take that outside line. Just get it. That's going to be that initial pass.
We have our pivot in the box for Houston, going to make it just a little bit more difficult for the jammer to come through. She realizes exactly that, decides to call the jam, especially as Queen Litigious was coming around looking to be in scoring potential. So 3 points.
So that's our first lead change of the game. Houston now out in front by 3. 25 minutes remain on the period clock. Adam skates, train hard, play smart, skate Adam. Adam, proud partner of the WFTDA then and now, adamskates.com.
Jamming for Houston, number 9 in the white, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly. Tara Ism, number 116 for Santa Cruz. She is to the outside of the turns. She's trying just now to move interior. Not able to do it. Runs and realizes there's 3 of white in there. The wrong move. Unfortunately, she is able to get around with a nice little bit of a spin, but she does indeed stay on her skate. Both times contentiously going out of bounds, but able to hold her skate lane. Before turn number 1, she is the lead jammer. Jammer for Houston now, having to recycle from between 1 and 2 all the way back between 1 and 4.
We've been seeing some great pack work here in the early going for Santa Cruz. Are getting one off to the box. That's Skirt Vonnegut taking a seat in the derbysupply.net penalty box. But it was nice pack work by Santa Cruz early on in that jam that helped free up their jammer as they moved as a unit of 4, coming over following that Houston jammer, but at the same time bumping their own jammer up ahead of the play and getting her that lead jammer status.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so. Bustin' Bieber, number 51, jamming for Houston. She is skating slowly around, eyeing up the backside of Corazon, number 23, who is leaning much lower. She is, though, right behind the wall of white, trying now to push through. She's got the four wall doing a beautiful job holding her back. They try to push her to the outside. The 3 then turns 1. They have to recycle the back, but she takes that interior lane, not in time, though, to take advantage of the opening.
And this is now going to be a power jam for Houston. A track cutting penalty issued to 23 Corazon, the jammer for Santa Cruz. And she's going to take a seat in that DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Though Buston Beaver not having much opportunity to take advantage of that right now, as there's some brilliant defense happening, particularly from the pivot who's right at the front, Shamrock and Roller. I see one of my favorite names, Beans, number 24. You know, he's getting in trouble with Beans.
Beans has been a formidable blocker for Santa Cruz all weekend, taking Buston Beaver to the outside line, blocking out a play, going to that DerbySupply.net penalty box is Beans.
Yep. So as we see, we've got number 51 coming back around, trying to eye up exactly which way she can go. She's going to have the passive switch to aggressive offense, trying to and successfully breaking apart that triangle three defense, but only to peel one off as there is a two. She's able to hold on that inside of Apex number one. She comes around, she picks up 4 points. That is the jammer Buston Beaver for Houston. We do have the jammer back out Corazon, number 23 for Santa Cruz, looking to see how she can move up through the pack, but she is now back in the penalty box.
Shamrock and Roller controlling the pack here for Santa Cruz. Serving that pivot role in a very traditional manner. She's actually the leader for that pack right now. She's up at the front with the backwards skating.
Corazon once again now standing, rejoining the pack. Pack has had a good opportunity to try and see what control that they have had. Not really able to switch offensively. Houston now pulls back into a defensive posture, getting right in front of Corazon.
It's a big jam there for Houston. They now have a 10-point lead, 22-12, 21-22 left on the period clock, Ryan.
You know, there's got to be some kind of inverted palindrome in there somewhere.
There is. I'm sure indeed that there is. We have an official timeout being signaled here. One of the jammer referees, Professor Murder, coming over to clarify some points.
Indeed. We will note that change if it does appear in front of us. But as we get back underway, Slayer Moon 91 in the white for Houston.
And looks like Roasted Pony 667 on the Fast Girls start line for Santa Cruz.
Yeah, our second time for Roasted Pony out there with the star. She was not able to get any points the first pass. Though Slayer Moon, who's been very effective thus far this weekend, only has 4 points so far in this game as we are 9 minutes fully in. 667 in the black at the back of the pack. We're seeing this a lot where you've got control of the front by one team, control of the back, and very often it seems as though Santa Cruz controlling that front line, that front quadrant of the pack up there.
Yeah, we saw Chelsea Smile, number 13 for Santa Cruz, on the recycling on Slayer Moon, trying to draw the track cut, didn't pay off, and now we have a lead jammer status awarded to Roasted Pony of Santa Cruz. Do have Slayer Moon hot on her wheels. No points come in on that one. Score remains at 22-12.
Feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, Wester, because I probably am. But what I'm seeing is that we have a strong defense from both of these teams, but I don't see a quick switch to strong offense. I see a lot of the times they're clustering up, and then what is happening is that if a jammer goes to the penalty box, they're just kind of waiting, you know, middling around. I don't see any real cohesive nature of going to that offensive strike.
No, it feels like both teams are still getting their bearings here. Of course, the first and only game of the day for all the teams here on Sunday. But looking for a bit of momentum, and momentum going now to Houston as Brandy Brown picks up lead jammer status.
The Queen Letitia's number 41 right behind her, maybe about a quarter track at this point. She's going to have a little bit more opportunity to get up into the pack. I've realized that the jammer for Houston did not quite see her coming in, but decided she's going to go more for points. I think that's probably a smart move, especially as we're early on in this game. There's no reason to just really kind of quit it. But the drawback, we do have 4 points now going on the Santa Cruz side. So sometimes you got to pay the piper.
Brandy Brown calls the jam, only gets a three on that one herself, having been lapped there by the Santa Cruz jammer. So a 4-3 jam in Santa Cruz's favor. A timeout now called by Santa Cruz. Made in the USA, made for Derby, Rydell Skates, offering unmatched quality and unmatched performance. They've been handcrafting those quality roller skates for 70 years. RydellSkates.com.
It looks like a timeout is being taken, and I appreciate that it's not an official review at this point. It's, I think, probably about kinds of contact, wanting to give a little bit of a warning, and we've seen that sporadically this weekend, but I think we've seen the official review used for that more often.
We have, and of course that has been a rule change this year, the allowance for official reviews to be used in place of a team timeout, often happening, say, late in the half. But if you're not going to have something to review, at least you're going to burn it instead of burning one of those TOs. And this is something we've been seeing actually from Houston all weekend. When they're taking their team timeouts, or during a team timeout, rather, this is not theirs, they're actually all congregating on the track rather than huddling at the benches. It's got to be a bit of a, we're going to get a sense of what it feels like when we're on the track and we're going to talk about things rather than X's and O's on the bench.
Well, and I think, again, like we say, there's no chance, obviously, to overturn anything. You're not looking for a change. You're looking for a different focus from your referees. That's when you want to use a timeout. Also, you have the benefit of resting your team, who is now down by 9 points. So I think that's one of the benefits that we have there as we come back to it. Tara Ism jamming for Santa Cruz. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly. She is wearing the star. She is also pushed to the outside for Houston, trying to come back in. Pulls herself on that interior. Haven't even entered turn one yet. Tara Ism gets a nice little burst of speed, and she is out as the lead jammer, as the pack still moving from turn one to two.
With another lead status going into Santa Cruz. They had a slight edge in lead jammer statuses thus far in the game, 6-4 in their favor.
Coming around now, Tara Ism with 5 points. Going to take them up to 21. One pass within tying, possibly catching up and overtaking Voodoo Dolly on her initial pass. Now she's able to score those points. Tara Ism in the middle of the pack, gets pushed to the interior and calls the jam.
Yeah, Speedo with the little hits there off the hips, knocking her to the infield, and jam called very quickly after that. We're going to reset on that fast girl start line. Roasted Pony for Santa Cruz and Slayer Moon for Houston. We have a 1-point game, though, Ryan. 25 for Houston, 24 for Santa Cruz. Just under 18 minutes left in the first half.
Yeah, definitely good awareness from all of our jammers. Definitely paying attention to their position on the track, where their pack is, and also great paying attention to the bench, as we've often talked about, is one of the most important things you can do, and we're seeing a lot of that happening here. As we get back to our action, Roasted Pony hopping and skipping, almost prancing, if you would, back and forth, trying to find which lane she can move forward, and not quite able to do so. She gets knocked down to the interior and is back up.
Yeah, Kelly Kilpowski, number 7 for Houston, taking a low block penalty, taking a seat in that DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Still no jammers through as they are across from the penalty boxes right now, entering into turn number 3. Great control, but once again, Santa Cruz with that rotating 3+1 wall. Nice little bit of a hit from... Unfortunately, I cannot see who it is. I'll let you know. But we saw the pivot try and go for the takeout on the Santa Cruz jammer. Houston comes in, makes contact, knocks her down.
And after about 50 seconds there, we finally do have a lead status awarded once again to Santa Cruz and Roasted Pony. Roasted Pony now on a scoring pass. Star comes off of the helmet of Slayer Moon, looking to see if this is a pass or a stash. Should be a stash at this point.
She's already passed the pivot number 11, Poisonberry Pie, who's now trying to move back up for some form of assistance.
Poisonberry Pie's coming up to the front.
And she does have the cover in her hand, though.
She does appear to have it in the hand, unless this is a really elaborate fake out. Does complete the initial pass. Star goes on the helmet, so a successful star pass. Roasted Pony, though, already with 5 points, calls it from just outside turn 4. Santa Cruz now out in front after that lead change, up by 4, 29-25. Be a lifer, get a lifer, S1 Helmets. S1 Helmets are rad, get rad, S1Helmets.com.
So we're just about a quarter of the way into our game. This is probably where a lot of people would be thinking these teams would start to play out. The way that Santa Cruz had come in as the number one seed, Houston comes in a little bit further back. Santa Cruz finally catching their wind and moving a little bit farther forward. We will see how that math continues to parse out as Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, number 9 for Houston, in the white. Queen Litigious, number 41 for Santa Fe. She currently is taking that inside lane. She got bumped to skate out, so she is waiting, letting the pack go past her to recycle. Doesn't have that far to travel.
Everybody coming to a dead stop almost between turns 1 and 2. Again, everybody just breaking into two separate packs, but a track cutting penalty drawn on the Houston Jammer. So Voodoo is going to take a seat in the DerbySupply.net penalty box. Power jam for Santa Cruz.
Yeah, you could see how she was definitely trying to skirt the edge of the cliff, and sometimes you just fall off, and that's exactly what happened. She got herself very quickly to the box. She wants to get that time burnt as fast as possible. As we got 4 points between the two teams, Santa Cruz 29, Houston at 25. Jammer continuing to push very, very hard, but cannot get any movement forward. And we're seeing some great defense from just the last two. That was number 31 and number 51. So that's 2x4 and Buston Beaver, who's been very effective offensively speaking earlier this weekend. Interesting, though, as we see Jammer come around, skate wide, and call the jam.
She does indeed. So result there, actually no points. It's donut time, 29-25, less than 15 minutes left in the first half. And Santa Cruz unable to take advantage of that power jam. Penalty has expired to Voodoo, so Houston can send out a fresh jammer. That'll be number 26 to the Fast Girl start line, Brandy Brown, facing 116 Terrorism for Santa Cruz.
Brandy Brown tries to make contact with Terrorism from the get-go off of the Fast Girl start line. Not able to make contact, but she does keep her momentum moving forward. Terrorism then pushes hard outside, gets knocked down. It's coming back into play at turn number four. Nice little bit of a hopper on number 21, Jekyll and Hyde, the captain for Houston, but she gets further up once again, knocked out at about that same spot. In the meanwhile, all attention is going to be focused over on the Houston side of jamming. Brandy Brown, lead jammer.
Now trying to get their jammer free. Santa Cruz moving into a more offensive posture for a moment. Do freer now. They can turn their attention to the D.
Brandy Brown gets pushed to the outside at turn number three. Looks back to see where the jammer is. Hears her bench yelling call and decides to do exactly that. 2 points gained for Houston. Going to bring them closer now. A one-point game. 29-28.
Gee whiz, Ryan. We've had nothing but close games thus far today here on Sunday. We had a four-point victory earlier. We had a couple more. We'll give you some more information on the day thus far as we have time. But once again, we are here in a very, very tight battle for third place.
Great utility player, Buston Beaver, number 51, jamming for Houston. She's wearing the white. Roasted Pony again, number 667, for Santa Cruz. Only 5 points on the day so far. Beaver at 13. She also happens to be the lead jammer right now.
Buston Beaver coming around into turn two.
Jammer is through Roasted Pony for Santa Cruz. She is now looking to see where she is going to enter the pack, but she will not have the opportunity as Buston Beaver was already there, had picked up 3 points, decides to conclude the jam to not lose any ground gained. That's going to take Houston 31 as the lead changes now to Santa Cruz's 29.
So Buston Beaver with that pass is now up to 16 points on the game. That ties her with Terrorism of Santa Cruz. They each have 16 points. They are the leading point getters. We also have a tie on the penalty count. Each team with so far is taking 8 trips to that DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Yeah, which considering only about 18 minutes in is not as bad as we've seen throughout this weekend, but still not the best numbers you want to be putting up in that category. Slayer Moon, number 91 for White in Houston. 4 points on her game so far. She is not the lead jammer. She was the second one through. Queen Letitia's number 41 now as lead jammer, coming into turn number one. Tries to swing her body around to see if she can get hips passed, and indeed she does. 3. That's a remarkable game for that kind of move.
Yep, so now Santa Cruz up by a single point, 32-31, 11 and a half minutes on the period clock. Each team with a blocker at that DerbySupply.net penalty box. Santa Cruz has somebody standing over there. Appears to be Skirt Vonnegut, so she'll be re-entering gameplay shortly.
Terrorism once again jamming Santa Cruz. Brandy Brown, number 26 in the white, holds her position on that inside line, tries to skirt through, is not able to do it. Now pulls herself back wide around, finds the hole, and takes full advantage of it. Brandy Brown is your lead jammer.
Houston targeting Terrorism on that initial run through the pack. Can't take her over the line. They're taking her so tantalizingly close to it.
Houston's jammer gets up. 3 points, calls it, sees Terrorism coming. And I think it's again, an aggressive game, but a smart game. And I think both of these teams are playing a very similar strategy. That's why we're seeing the score being so close right now.
Indeed, Ryan. And again, the relatively low penalty count, keeping a lot of bodies on the track, so everybody's able to do their set plays quite easily right now, mm-hmm. and that's causing a lot of problems for these jammers. Nobody putting up double-digit jams thus far.
As we go back to our jamming, we have Voodoo. She is jamming for Houston, and Roasted Pony, number 667 for Santa Fe, trying to take a line on the outside. She gets knocked down to a knee. She's going to recycle back right across from the benches. Number 7 from Houston doing a nice job of holding her down. That is Kelly Kilpowski. She's been very effective throughout our weekend as well. Good jamming from both of these squads. We're seeing it really play effect right here. We have a lead jammer. That is Voodoo. But right behind her is number 667. Once again, Roasted Pony for Santa Cruz.
Santa Cruz taking the front wall, going to try to make it difficult for those points to get called in for Voodoo, and indeed they are able to put up a shutout. No points scored for either side, and that's going to keep this one tight as a two-point lead for Houston, 34-32, 9 minutes plus on the period clock. We don't sell it if we wouldn't play in it. The first, the best, and happy to fix the rest. That is SinCitySkates.com.
2 point difference between our two teams. Slayer Moon, number 91 in the white for Houston. Queen Letizia's 41 in the black for Santa Fe. 91 tries to take that outside line. She is able to skirt that, but there was a whistle, and indeed it was because of track cut. She pushed a little bit too far. Slayer Moon going to the penalty box.
This will be her second visit to the DerbySupply.net penalty box. Power jam for Santa Cruz. Santa Cruz is going to need to see if they can cruise through this one. Up front for Houston, we're looking at 2X Force teaming up there with, I believe that's Betty Watchett. And they're just not giving any quarter right now to Queen Litigious. Finally, though, they are pushed just beyond the pack, so they have to let her go. That's that initial pass. Now Queen Litigious in the driver's seat on this power jam.
As she comes up, a foul of number 31, particularly for Houston. She does so without too much pressure, which is great. So 2x4 is not going to get her into the penalty box, but she now pushes, again, same position. She doesn't have any speed or momentum. The opposite of Slayer Moon, who was able to come out of the box very quickly, get through without anybody even noticing her, and come up right behind. Unfortunately for her, though, not enough speed to propel her into the pack. 5 points for Santa Cruz.
This next one will start as a 4-3 pack advantage for Santa Cruz. They've got 2x4s now in that DerbySupply.net penalty box for a multiplayer block. Tara Ism on the fast girl start line for Santa Cruz. Number 26, Brandy Brown for Houston.
Whistle has happened. Nobody moving very quickly until there. It's that interesting, that slow. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? I'm going to go like this. And Tara Ism decides to do exactly that. Up through the middle. Tries to take the outside. Is not quite able to do it. She has got to recycle herself at the very back of the pack. That was some jazz fingers from Hellcat saying, it was me. Come and get me. And indeed, she has to do that to re-enter legally. We've got our jammer through, but not lead jammer. A smart move. Jammer comes through for Houston. She has half a track around just as the lead was established for Santa Cruz. She calls it.
Yep, so no points there. Santa Cruz 37, Houston 34. Less than 7 minutes remain. Things moving at a very brisk pace. Minimal timeouts thus far, Ryan. And even every jam, we've already got 19 in the books. Wouldn't surprise me if we get up to a quarter century by the time halftime comes.
Oh, very easily. Especially we've got Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, number 9 for Houston. Not the lead jammer because that has already been earned by Roasted Pony in the black for Santa Cruz. Coming back around now, looking to see where she can move. She's got a 3-wall to come up against. And indeed, once again, it's number 31. Very often 2x4 in there.
Star pass in progress. Speedo now strapping on the star, having received it from Voodoo. But it's a 4-point gain there for Santa Cruz. Yep. And timeout being signaled by Carl Schultz from the bench of Houston. So 41 for Santa Cruz, 34 for Houston. And if you're just joining us, first of all, where were you this morning? Second of all, we've already had our 9th place, 7th place, and just recently our 5th place games. Earlier this morning, Columbia with a heart-stopping victory over Treasure Valley, 133-129. That was followed by the seventh-place game, which was taken by Jet City, 179, over Oklahoma Victory Dolls, 137. And most recently, we had another incredible finish in a battle between St. Chuck's and Brandywine. St. Chuck's 216, Brandywine 215. They actually opened the tournament Friday morning, and that was a 10-point victory for St. Chuck's. So this time they took off that zero, moved over the decimal point, and squeaked through with that first-place victory. Sorry, that one-point victory, and they take fifth. This is the battle for third.
And I think that's what's interesting is that's a good example of sometimes the parity and how the ranking system definitely works. If you've got people that really are coming in at a certain level, they're moving across as a certain level, we see them. Two times we've had matchups, repeats from our opening day as our action back underway in just a moment. Here it goes, Slayer Moon on the jam. We've also got Terra Ism off the Fast Girls start line. Just like that, Whistler.
Very quickly up the outside. They open up lanes 3 and 4, so she only had to take one, and she did for that lead status. We do have Slayer Moon about half a lap behind, but gaining on the pack.
Kelly Hilpowski going to the penalty box. Looking at the jammers on both of these sides, I was using Ringster here, and there's names that we've been saying this entire weekend on both sides quite fully. Very effective, and I think that's one of the things we're seeing, one of the lower scores going into the halftime, definitely this game.
For sure. Right now it's only 11 points in Santa Cruz's favor, 45-34. Still have 5 minutes on the period clock. All your derby needs, derbysupply.net, just hit it.
Queen Letitia's number 41, jamming for Santa Cruz. Brandy Brown, number 26 in the white. She tries to take the outside lane and does indeed find success this time around. She becomes the lead jammer. Queen Letitia's, though, has got 2-1 to beat, and she does so right up through the middle, but half a track around. Pack moving a little bit more quickly now as they come between turn number 2 and 3, making some definite work. For our jammer to come around are both number 4 and 8, respectively. Health Hazard and Shamrock and Roller. Once again, Santa Cruz doing great defensive work.
Shamrock and Roller continually is the bane of every jammer's existence this weekend. 4 points do come in here for Queen Letitia, and she's going back for more. Direction of gameplay penalty being issued to Santa Cruz's Health Hazard, number 4. She's going to take a seat in that derbysupply.net penalty box, joined by her teammate Shamrock and Roller. That's going to free up a bit of space for Houston and Brandy Brown.
Yeah, Shamrock and Roller was definitely trying to pull the cut call on Brandywine, and she was not, Brandy Brown, not able to do it because she herself kind of had stepped out of bounds. So I think a great attempt at a play, just the position was a little bit off. Brandy Brown is able to stay on the track and, to her benefit, able to pick up 5 points in that process.
Meanwhile, Heloise has received the star, is the jammer of record now for Santa Cruz. Hop a skip and a bit of a waggle getting through the inside line. Doesn't go over on that previous pass. Now completing another one, crossing wires there with Kelly Kilpowski. Puts up more points for Santa Cruz.
Interesting, though, we've got 4 points and 4 points. That's going to negate that last pass, and that does bring us back to a two-point game. Santa Cruz 57, Houston 55, with 3:15 left to play in our first half.
And so, as we were saying, this whole weekend, seeing the ranking system at work, and it's a bit of a shuffling of the cards, and now everybody is kind of falling into play, and that's what's resulting into these really tight battles that have been really intriguing and exciting to watch all day.
Yeah, especially as we, with these teams that we've been watching today, are definitely just across in that Division II boundary. Bustin' Beaver 51 is jamming for Houston. Roasted Pony is currently jamming for Santa Cruz. She is at the back of the pack, but right in front of her, Houston's jammer, Bustin' Beaver, trying to look for some assistance, not able to get it, and they just kind of rotate back and forth to see who has control of the front of the pack. Neither yet able to get through it. Pack moving very quickly.
The pivot for Houston, number 16, Mistilla, taking a seat in the derbysupply.net penalty box for a forearm penalty.
But Roasted Pony, in the meanwhile, has come through as the lead jammer. The other jammer, though, is out. Houston trying to come back around. And not to be surprised, we see the jammer come through, get those 4 points, call the jam before Houston's jammer can come up and make some contact. 61-55 in the favor of Santa Cruz.
Santa Cruz up by six at this moment in time. Adam skates, train hard, play smart, skate Adam. Number 91, Slayer Moon on the Fast Girls start line for Houston, and that's going to be Terrorism once again countering for Santa Cruz, 1-1-6. Jammers leaning against each other. Terrorism is going to roll off and try to reset, but she is quickly followed by Slayer Moon. This time, though, door is shut by Santa Cruz's blockers. Terrorism, meanwhile, getting cycled back here by it's number 31, 2x4s. Pardon me, a little frog in there.
One of the interesting things that we've seen is that they keep putting Terrorism out there. She's only gotten 20 points, but that's a third of the points that Santa Cruz has thus far, so she's definitely been effective. Slayer Moon, though, not nearly as effective as we've seen her in earlier games, only 4 points, but she's been out again several times, almost kind of giving the other jammers a bit of a breather really effectively this first half.
Watching Terrorism as she slowly comes off the track, and she's waiting for the hand signal to see how many points she earned on that pass, and it's a deuce. No points come in for Houston, so now an 8-point lead for the Boardwalk Bombshells. Less than a minute on the period clock. We do have time for another one, though.
Santa Cruz 63, Houston 55. We will see how they take this out into our halftime. Very often people talk about wanting to have that momentum gain into half to try and come up with some emotionally strategic benefit as they come back out of it, but we will see what Brandi Brown could do to stop that as she is jamming currently for Houston. Caught up in the middle of the pack, it swirled around. She's got the pivot plus one to get past. Almost able to do it on the inside line, but the pivot has a little bit too much power. Although,
speaking of power, we have a power jam here developing for Houston as number 41, Queen Litigious, with a forearm penalty on the outside, is taking that seat in the DerbySupply.net penalty box. Brandi Brown looking to see if she can take control. Gets a bit of an opening on the outside, has a couple more skaters to beat, but Beans now joined by Shamrock and Roller and Health Hazard, and they are creating a hazard for Brandi Brown.
Yeah, definitely a very strong penalty kill happening right now. Queen Latijas is standing in the box. Brandi Brown had gotten pushed to the inside. Big hit on the pivot for Santa Cruz. I believe a high block being called, sending the skater over.
Yeah, that was actually Beans picking up that penalty. There was a little bit of confusion. The skater's like, me? You mean me? But Beans is the one that's going to take it. And judging from the smile on her face, she's willing to take that one.
She was past the point of no return, so she's got to go all the way around on the outside. Queen Litigious is, though, back up between corner now three through to four. Takes the shallower of lanes. Is able to get past Jekyll and Heidi to come out. That is her initial pass, however. We still have some points going up four on the side of Houston, trying to get it closer, just able now to take it to 59-63. But Queen Litigious able to nullify that, picking up four of her own with 18 seconds left in our first half.
We've had a successful star pass, by the way. Poisonberry Pie, the pivot, a lot of peas in there, having received the star, is jamming currently for Houston. She actually did a little bit of a handstand at one point as she was making her way through the track just to stay in bounds. Both teams picking up 4 points there at the end, and as the math gets added up, we are currently looking at a score of 71 for Santa Cruz, 63 for Houston, still only a single-digit lead. An official review has been signaled here, requested by Houston. Mm-hmm. We will bring you the result of that review at the conclusion of halftime, Ryan. And we do, again, we have this single-point lead here. Mm-hmm. Single-digit point lead, I should say, for Santa Cruz. Only 8 points. Penalties starting to come into play. We'll have a penalty report after halftime as well. Santa Cruz in their game last night, they were basically the big upset against Demolition City, who goes to the final later this afternoon. Santa Cruz had picked up 44 penalties in that game, so they're looking to keep that lid on it. And so far, they're below that pace.
One of the things that I think we've been talking about this whole game is that nobody has had specific control, though a few times Santa Cruz starts to get that and then they lose it, like maybe two, three times. I think we're seeing this cycle one more time. So we're going to see what they talk about in the half, but I'm curious what people at home, using the hashtag #TalkToWFTDA, what do you think that these two teams need to do to try and open this up one direction or the other? We're going to find out what your thoughts are when we come back in our half.
And we are back coming out of halftime. I'm Mr. Whistler, and I'm joined here by the esteemed Ryan Will. And you are watching the 2015 International WFTDA Division II playoffs here in Cleveland, Ohio, the first of two Division II playoffs. Your halftime score is 71 for Santa Cruz, 63 for Houston, an 8-point lead for Santa Cruz. We're just saying, it seems like today everybody is trying their darndest to give us an overtime jam, and we've just yet to get there. But
we're all rooting for it to happen.
Yeah, we're on pace.
Not quite there yet. Well, we'll see what happens as, again, our score is 71-63 in favor of Santa Cruz. A phrase that I've spent the last 15 minutes saying, oh, Santa Cruz, it's Santa Cruz. So I apologize to the team, the city, and the skateboard company. It is Santa Cruz who is skating phenomenally here, and I will do my darndest to get that right. As we have Houston, again, 63. I think the thing that we were talking about coming into our half is, what's going to be that big change? What can one of these teams do over the other? And we asked all of you out there in the wonderful world of Twitter, and the best thing that we heard was that, truthfully, Mr. Whistler sounds like an angel.
Oh, indeed.
I believe you do. I'm going to agree with Myra F. Nutt and Smoke Akola watching back in Toronto.
And I do have some numbers from the first half to throw at everybody. In terms of penalties, total penalties so far for Santa Cruz, 15. Houston was 16. Jammer penalties, 3 for Santa Cruz, 2 for Houston. So no significant edges there. Lead percentages, Terraism for Santa Cruz with a 75% lead percentage. A couple in the 60s for Houston. That's going to be Bustin Beaver along with Brandy Brown, 67 and 63 respectively. Perhaps one thing that is a surprise, we're saying Slayer Moon has taken 9 trips to the Fast Girl start line for Houston, only picking up a lead percentage of 13%. So that's something that, of course, is maybe cause for concern for Houston. But they're only down by 8 points, and we've got a whole half here to go.
Yeah, and I think that that's a thing we've been talking about a little bit. As Slayer Moon is out on the jam line right now, she is number 91 in the white. We have seen that she's usually much more effective when she gets that lead jammer. She's able to get those points. And I think that was a good point brought up here on our panel, that she, because of the lower percentage, may not just be able to adjust the way that Santa Cruz has been playing. So we get back to our action. Slayer Moon in the white. She is up against Queen Litigious, number 41, in the black. Both of them tearing that inside line, trying to get a bit of a push. Interesting bridge, though. The pivot holding onto her own jammer can't really release to give her an opportunity through, because that'll then also open up the hole for Houston. Houston now at the back of the four wall. Nice bridge across as they go through turn number one. But lead jammer, that is going to be number 41. It currently is Queen Litigious.
And everybody takes a seat in the middle of the track. It turns one and two. We do have Slayer Moon through on that initial pass. Not in time to cause any damage on the scoreboard. Santa Cruz picking up 4 as Queen Litigious calls that jam. Missed out? Have you missed out on anything this weekend?
You know, there's always so much going on. Invariably, I miss out a little bit, but I try my best.
Did you miss out on anything last year, such as 2014 playoff and championship merchandise?
I did.
Well, you can complete your collection at the WFTDA online store. That's online at WFTDA.com/store, because we do not put backslashes in URLs.
You'll have to let me know why that is. You know, I've never known. Number 26, Brandy Brown in the white for Houston. Terraism. She is the jammer for Santa Cruz at the back of the pack right now. She has got, again, every time I look, it seems to be number 31, 2x4s is right in front of her. Definitely has something figured out going on there.
And we basically have a couple of tornadoes, the blockers there. We had a drawback attempt for number 13, Chelsea Smile, but when that doesn't take, she goes right back up. And we've got two knots, essentially, not forming any recognizable geometric pattern. Now they're getting split apart as we're moving from a bit of offense to defense, and then it's like one person does offense, another one comes in to do to replace her, so she can now go on to the D. And once again, we've now fallen into those two knots. Mm-hmm. The front knot, though, breaks apart courtesy of a multi-block penalty being issued to Santa Cruz's number 86, Heartless Harpy. Lead status going to Brandy Brown for Houston.
Well, because Jammer was coming in, Brandy Brown, that allows everybody to kind of refocus, look around them. Terraism is able to take advantage of that. She is now through on her initial pass, coming around, but Brandy Brown doing the same thing that was done to her team, a jam before, gets through, picks up points, and calls it a 4 gain, taking Santa Cruz staying 75, Houston up 67.
One group of numbers we did not give you coming out of the half are the leading point getters. Brandy Brown, with those 4 points, is the leading point getter in this game thus far. She has 38 points for Houston, so that represents, of course, more than half of their point total thus far. On the Santa Cruz side of the ledger, Queen Litigious, the leading point scorer, with 30.
As we get back to it, someone who has previously had some big points put up as well, but right now only one, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly. She is jamming on Houston's side. Santa Cruz is Corazon. She is out right now as your lead jammer. She is between 3 and 4, picking up some speed, trying to eye up which way she can go. We're continuing to see a little bit of disorganization in the pack. There's no real control. It's really allowing our jammers to get up into the middle, but then again, everything kind of swirling around them.
Corazon very confidently just keeps skating forward, knowing that number 16, Mastilla, was going to have to peel back and let her through. Completed a first pass there. Coming around the outside, calls it, picks up 3 more points.
But we saw that there was the stash. Number 9 had come around. She had it in her hand. Voodoo was coming in, and she took that interior lane. And I think, you know, physics is your friend at that moment, because she was able to just hold her one skate in and actually lean and use that momentum to hold her in bounds and pick up 2 before that fourth whistle, and she collapsed to the interior.
We do have 2 blockers in the DerbySupply.net penalty box for Houston. It's Kelly Kilpowski, and also appears to be number 51, which is Bustin Beaver.
Slayer Moon jamming for Houston. Roasted Pony jamming Santa Cruz. Right away, we have a multiplayer block that is being called on number 19, Betty Watchett. She's now going to the penalty box.
As they're coming around at turn 2, Slayer Moon getting knocked towards the inside. I think she thought that she had landed that skate cleanly. However, she did not. Track cutting call signaled. This is a power jam for Santa Cruz. Santa Cruz starting to pull away just a wee bit. They're up at 87, Houston 69.
Roasted Pony did only get 4 points on that pass because she was still behind the jammer for Houston when the jammer for Houston went out. So she was eligible to pick up that pass, unfortunately.
What she's also eligible to receive here is a high blocking penalty. So she's going to take a seat in the DerbySupply.net penalty box. That is going to spring Slayer Moon. This one going to go the full 2. Power jam for Houston. Slayer Moon already with the star in hand, waiting to see if this is stash or pass. It's going to be stash. Coming back on, that's the initial. Pack is resetting and waiting on the far straightaway. Skirt Vonnegut quarterbacking this blocking core.
Jammer is back in for Santa Cruz. We have to look those. Chelsea Smile also back in. She had gone to the penalty box about the same time. So everyone is back out on the track.
Roasted Pony in the middle of the pack as Slayer Moon comes in hot at the back. Forearm penalty, though, being issued to number 7, Kelly Kilpowski for Houston.
Yeah, again and again and again, she's getting knocked down. It's Jem Jones who's kind of holding court at the back. Jammer for Houston still looking to see if she can get through the pack. But a 5-point pass has happened from Santa Cruz and Roasted Pony. That is going to take their score very close to 100. They're about 8 points down from that as they sit 92. Houston a little bit of a nudge as well, as they are now 78, 7 minutes into our second half.
Yeah, 4 more points did come in for Houston there to bring it to 78. And Kelly Kapowski in that DerbySupply.net penalty box is on her 5th visit, getting her passport stamped. So she's only got a couple more to go, and she'll have a full set. Not a collection everybody wants to get.
Yeah, I'm more of a commemorative plate man myself.
Flattened pennies.
Speedo jamming for Houston. Number 3 in the white at the back of the pack, trying to move around the outside. Sees Hazard, can't go that way. She's 24, can't go that way. Beans is not letting her go up that inside lane. But the inside lane now is a not unfortunate place for Queen Litigious, as she had gotten knocked in. Pivot for Houston, got a piece of her, but not enough. She can come around on the outside successfully, and does. Queen Litigious, lead jammer.
Speedo taken to the outside line, just safely re-enters behind Health Hazard. Shamrock and Roller with the takeout. But that's going to allow Speedo to get through. This was Speedo's first start on the Fast Girls start line, with the star unable to score. And in fact, a track cut issued. That's actually to the pivot.
Yes.
Number 6, who is Hellcat F6F.
Hellcat.
We'll just go with Hellcat.
That
the F6F, it's one of those things that's it's a little bit of a tongue twister.
Yeah, if you feel like you know what that is, let us know. Hashtag talk to WFTDA, because I'm actually very curious. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly number 9 for Houston in the white, jamming against Terraism. 116. She's trying to take that interior lane, not able to find any. Purchase decides to move to the outside, but unfortunately she has a three-wall brace holding her back. Nice bit of a move around for the jammer in white, but unfortunately she pushes a little too hard, goes wide to the inside, comes back again, just scattered. I mean, that's the word that keeps coming to my mind, Whistler. Scattered.
It's like we're watching like an old school version of Asteroids on an old, you know, monochromatic computer screen, as we're seeing them get split apart, but they keep managing to get back into that nice isosceles triangle shape. And at the end of that one, we do have a 1 point coming in for Santa Cruz. Just one after all that. 96 on the scoreboard for the Boardwalk Bombshells. Houston 78, 21 minutes, 20 seconds left on the period clock. Roll faster and farther with Quick Ceramic Bearings. Quick Bearings, when you want quality, think Quick.
Corazon 23 for Santa Cruz, jamming against Bustin' Beaver 51 for Houston. Bustin' Beaver tries to take the inside line, is not going to be able to get anywhere on it, decides to pull herself back. She's got the three wall to get past, broken down now to the two, as there was a bit of a stumble there from Jem Jones, but she is back up on her feet and back into the triangle. But we have a four wall, nice across, almost a 3+1 with that brace on the outside, holding back the jammer for Santa Cruz. Corazon not really getting to move anywhere until, once again, it's like there's some small explosion that just breaks the pack apart, and it's not any kind of impact. I can't quite figure out where we go from these great braces, and then it just starts to spread apart.
Now a power jam developing here for Houston. Corazon with a four-run penalty, taking a seat in the DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Busta Beaver has to pull herself back to make sure she has re-entered legally, and she does so very well. Gets a nice little bit of a shove from her teammate, Mistilla, but not enough to move her anywhere forward, just into the back of 1384 on the side of Santa Cruz, who's doing a great job being a part of those braces. Eloise has been a big member of those triangles, as we've seen, already bracing for them right now as we're going to a nice little bit of a bump out there. But once again, it seems as though they start to spread out. They get too far out, and the jammers are really able to take advantage of that. So our triangles are just dissolving as our jammers come through. But what's interesting is that even though that happens, we're still having that last one pull out and be a strong defender, getting that push to the inside or the outside.
Corazon, having served her time in the DerbySupply.net penalty box, re-entering and being recycled and being taken back there by Mistilla. Shamrock and Roller attacking the Bustin' Beaver, who's got the star in her hand and was going for the stash. She's now recycled all the way back to turn two. Corazon having to re-enter herself, taking the long way back. Both jammers looking quite fatigued at the end of this one. They're both taking a fair bit of abuse. And we're going to have a team timeout called here by Houston. And we'd like to thank Coach Dad for responding on Twitter. Hellcat F6F is a World War II fighter plane. So thank you for that clarification from Coach Dad.
Yeah. You know, Coach Dad being very vocal with his fingers this weekend. We want to appreciate everyone who has been on our social media outlets. Really appreciate everyone who has been here with their signs. I see Kent the politician, who I don't know who gave him markers and how he snuck that much construction paper into this building. This one currently even saying, I made more signs.
Right you are, Ryan. All your derby needs, DerbySupply.net. Just hit it.
As we come back to looking at our penalties, nobody in real trouble with the exception of Kelly Kilpowski, number 7 for Houston. She is at 5 trips. We have a couple of threes, but more so on the side of Santa Cruz. Otherwise, they're fairly well evenly spread out.
Yeah, nobody with a 4. We are seeing both teams are kind of relying on some of the same skaters over and over again. So they're both running kind of short benches, although they are getting all 14 skaters on each side into this game. And this game has now gotten back underway. Slayer Moon coming off the Fast Girls start line. and wearing the star for Santa Cruz Roasted Ponies, 667. Neither jammer through just yet, although Slayer Moon with a move around the outside, taken over the line by Beans, and that is a track-cutting penalty. Nice heads-up move there by Beans, and this is a power jam for Santa Cruz.
Yeah, Skirt Vonnegut also a good part of that. Gets the hop and also pulls herself back. And she's one of those people we don't talk enough about because she's been out there 17 times, only two trips to the box. We have a number of players who've been out there well over a dozen and few times. Those are the ones you just see backboning in the pack, just always consistently a part of it, who don't get as much attention as, unfortunately, we definitely should give them.
Well, indeed, Skirt Vonnegut with a really strong positional blocking, not going in for the big swoopy hits, mm-hmm. but just getting in the way and being a barrier. And getting in the way there was the forearm of Roasted Pony, number 667. Now it's a power jam for Houston.
Yep.
And Slayer Moon back on the track, already in the pack.
That was good work from Patty Payne's number 96 for Houston to put herself in front to allow the hit to come in. A little bit too forearmy from our jammer, who now is the jammer number 91 for Houston. She is through Slayer Moon on her initial pass. It's a remarkable thing to say. It took her 120 seconds. Actually, the other's 80, but.
So that is a 5-point pass for Slayer Moon. Slayer Moon coming back for more. It's still time on this jam clock. Unleash number 444. That is the path of resistance. And now we're seeing this triangle staying quite tight. Beans going for the takeout, swing and a miss. And through for the 5-point pass is Slayer Moon. Has a few seconds to see if she can catch that pack and get any more points. Probably not gonna just do it.
Interestingly though, we have the jammer coming out. Santa Cruz also picking up 5 points to negate that gain. Good update for your score here. Looks like Santa Cruz at 101, Houston at 88. I think what we're seeing as a result of that little bit of a last minute bump into the half and then out of the half, but otherwise we're seeing consistent movement on both of these teams. So nobody, once again, really running away with it, with the exception of Santa Cruz, and just a little bit those two times.
Yeah, so it's only a 13-point lead here and not quite halfway through the second half. Brandy Brown coming off the fast girl start line for Houston, but the lead jammer set is going to Queen Litigious, number 41 in Santa Cruz.
Yeah, she was able to make a nice move right up through between turn number one and two, but we have now a cutting the track penalty being issued to Speedo as she is going rather quickly to the penalty box. So that's going to give a nice power jam advantage to Queen Litigious, who see if she can add on to that 13-point difference. She's getting a nice little bit of a stall position, just waiting until 20 feet appears, and indeed it does. Mistilla has to let up on her. Now we see as our pack just holding still. We go from a passive offense, now making contact with the three wall, becomes aggressive as two blockers come up, break it up a little bit, but
power jam opportunity slipping away here for Santa Cruz, though. Queen Litigious with the back blocking penalty over by turn three, right around the same time that Brandy Brown's penalty for cutting the track ends. So that pendulum swinging in the opposite direction. Five lead jam statuses in a row for Santa Cruz, although this one, of course, lost on that back blocking call.
Brandy Brown was almost at the 30 seconds anyway, so we are going to have a nice little bit of an opportunity to make up some of the loss that Queen Litigious had put up there. She had gotten 5 points. That was now 106 to 88. Brandy Brown is only through on her initial pass, so she's really got to try and get through here right now with 30 seconds left, but she's got to pull it away as Queen Litigious is back on the track.
And low blocking penalty being called on Shamrock and Roller. She goes straight to the DerbySupply.net penalty box. Both jammers now gauging with the pack. Elbowing call on Skirt Vonnegut. 5 points come in there for Brandy Brown.
Queen Litigious gets recycled to the inside, but she's got to go all the way from apex to come back in legally. But nice bit of a pass. No one's really paying attention on the outside. And then that's where Brandy Brown comes through, picks up another 4 points, tries to close that gap, and does so. A little bit is all it takes. Just a couple more times, and they will catch up. As we have still, though, 13 points between these teams.
So that one wound up being a draw.
Which ultimately did not look like that's the way it was going to at the start.
No, not indeed. So So it's still a very interesting game. Like, we were talking about this at the half, the first couple of jams, trying to figure out what kind of a game is this going to be. And we're mostly seeing both teams just willing to slightly chisel away at the scoreboard. Nobody going and putting up the big, big jam to make that statement.
Well, I think that we're going to see something interesting here. Buston Beaver came through, picked up 3 points, calls the jam. And I think that's, like you say, where we've been getting. It's a little foothold, a little finger hold, and trying to crawl away, and then the other team catches up. But it's not as though I can pinpoint if it's going to be because strong offense or strong defense, because we see them momentarily very, very strong. But then at other times, it just seems to fall apart and they lose that momentum. So it's not one factor or the other. I think almost it's an overall lack of a consistency in one department or the other. And that's why we're seeing sometimes they get through, sometimes they get through.
Mm-hmm. And we have only a 10-point gap now. Santa Cruz in that lead, 110 to an even 100 for Houston. Slayer Moon with the star for Houston. That's Roasted Pony with the star for Santa Cruz. Poisonberry Pie and Jekyll and Heidi with the recycle on Roasted Pony.
She is trying the jammer for Santa Cruz to get past. The pivot eyes are up directly, and the jammer just inches back. Roasted Pony's almost like challenging, like, I'm going to wind up speed and come and get you. The problem when you do that is you can push forward too hard or you can bounce out too wide. She does exactly that. Roasted Pony going to the penalty box for cutting the track.
Slayer Moon with a bit of a pirouette to stay in bounds. Now has to get around Heartless Harpy and does earn lead jammer status. That one took almost a minute to come in. She is on a power jam as we have Roasted Pony in that DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Nice bit of work. 86. Heartless Harpy gets a piece of the jammer, knocks her out. Realizes that not only did she slow her down, she comes back in and pulled herself back. So we now have a jammer switcheroo. I'm not going to call it a do-si-do. I just did.
Bingo.
There it is. So now Slayer Moon is in the penalty box. She's got 23 points so far in this game, a quarter of what Houston has earned, essentially. But she's got to sit for a while, and that gives Roasted Pony an opportunity to add to the 28 she has already gotten for her team's 110.
Yeah, Jekyll and Heidi and Kelly Kilpowski at the back of that pack getting split up by Beans. So Roasted Pony working on edging her way forwards on this power jam, which is winding down as Slayer Moon has now re-entered the track. Slayer Moon contending with four Santa Cruz blockers up at the front. Skirt Vonnegut teaming up with Heartless Harpy, and Shamrock and Roller tries to take her to the line, but she's not going.
Houston's able to pick up five. That's going to bring them within five as they are now at 105 to Santa Cruz 110. As we have in the meanwhile a timeout that has been called.
Timeout called by Santa Cruz. So at this point in the game, that'll leave Santa Cruz with a timeout left on the board after this. They still have an official review, of course. Same situation for Houston. So again, we're seeing a lot of evens in pretty much every category you can categorize with a statistic.
It's very true, and Lightning Slim has said something I think is very true, which is it's almost as if lead hasn't affected scoring here. The way these two teams have matched up, the way that they're both acting offensively and defensively, I think this is potentially the most even matched out of the teams we've seen all weekend.
Well, it is. And what's interesting, of course, is, you know, we noted coming right off the top of the game, Santa Cruz comes into this weekend as the number one seed at this tournament, ranked number 42 overall in the WFTDA, just dropping out of Division I territory. Houston, however, ranked at number six, seeded at number six, I should say. They are ranked number 53 overall in the WFTDA. Houston, of course, has already improved their seeding regardless of the outcome of this game, which will determine third and fourth.
Yeah, you're right. Both of these teams have taken a dip. We do, like you say, 42 at Santa Cruz, but that's where Houston had been the first half of the season. So I think we're seeing a return to about that even keel matching. Queen Letitia's 41 is lead jammer for Santa Cruz. Speed O out of the box. Nope, she's got to go around on the outside now.
Passing that point of no return. Now we're able to see that track cutting hand signal. So that is what she is going to serve time for in the DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Hearing an errant whistle here or there.
Forearm penalty coming in on Houston's number 19, and that's going to be Betty Watchett.
But again, a little bit of a scramble at the pack. No real control one way or the other. Queen Letizia is able to take advantage of that. Shakes her fists in the air, tries to give the signal. Comes in, turns the body around, gets the one point, gets the other on the pass, moving along that inside lane. She's got one more to get past. She is getting some assistance. Nice bit of a muscle down there from... That is Corazon. She's often been in our jammer position, but she's been a very good defensive blocker. And as we see right there, understands the positioning our jammer needs to get in, opens that lane up knowing the jammer gets it as well, follows through.
And now that power jam is over, with Speedo back on the track, we've got Corazon up front teaming up with Health Hazard. Forearm penalty coming in on Speedo, who returns to the DerbySupply.net penalty box.
Yeah, the only bit of good news about that is she wasn't past the point of no return, so she could go directly in. So that will save her at least an additional 5 seconds. The jam is concluded now as Santa Cruz once again starting to pull away. They're at 123 to Houston's 105, but with 9.5 minutes left to go, the plenty of time and the amount of ways that we've seen these two teams change it up.
Yeah, 18-point lead, the greatest lead of the half for Santa Cruz at this point. But now they've got yet another power start. Terraism is going to be the only jammer to start this one at the Fast Girls start line. And not passive offense at all. As those two pairs come in very quickly, they're going to try to spring their jammer. Gets through, and she picks up lead status.
That was great work from Jem Jones, the blocker, 0-0-1-8 for Santa Cruz. Pinballing off of the... blockers for Houston, not allowing them to wedge up. Houston's really had a nice strong triangle. Jem Jones really bouncing it around, keeping that open. Terry isn't able to get through there, so she had gotten that lead jammer. Now looking for the points, and she picks up all of them. 5 points for Santa Cruz.
Speedo returning to the track, working on an initial pass. Terraism, though, working on another scoring pass around the outside. Shamrock and Roller again with the drawback. Can't take her too far, though. Gets stopped in her tracks by Jekyll and Heidi. Poisonberry Pie being recycled.
She's got the helmet cover in her hand. She's trying to take that outside lane. Nice little bit of a sneak, but it was not completely missed. Beans saw it, got the bump out. That slowed that progression for Poisonberry Pie to get outside. She's half a track away when they call the jam. Right at turn number 4.
Yeah, Beans with the good eyes in this entire game, actually.
So sport goggles she wears, I think, really.
It very well could be, indeed, Ryan. We saw on that last pass during that power jam, it was about a 2.5 count of Queen Letizia's engaging until, bang, going to enter and create some nice offense.
That's just the prettiest way to say nice offense.
That offense is swell.
That was awesome. Number 26, Brandy Brown in white for Houston is jamming. Roasted Pony, 667, jamming for Santa Cruz. A little bit of reversal. Usually we see Santa Fe controlling the front, but we have a broken up. Number 23, Corazon, has really become an effective blocker in the second half. She has put up points of her own 9 in this game so far, but I think that they've really started to switch her out because she understands where those jammers need to be and is giving those opportunities.
She is. Now coming up the inside, though, for Houston right now, Brandy Brown picking up the lead status, still looking for Roasted Pony to make her own way through. She does there. Now it's going to be interesting what Houston does here, what kind of offense they're going to run. And big hit on Brandy Brown, a little slow to get up and may have winded her just a little bit, but she did put up 4 big points there for Houston. So Houston sitting at 109, and that's actually 51 points total so far in this game for Brandy Brown. Queen Letizia's, though, still leading on the other side, though, 55 for Santa Cruz. Again, everything's staying very even. 137 to 109, though, it's still an 18-point lead for Santa Cruz.
Queen Letizia's jamming for Santa Cruz. Voodoo jamming for Houston. She gets pushed to the interior before turn number 1. She now tries to come back and get around Health Hazard, not quite able to do so. Queen Letizia, though, is able to make some movement, and she does so. She becomes lead jammer. It's hard to call that a wall. It's like a water wall. It's like a swirling.
Well, what they've been doing kind of consistently is they almost form a bit of a conga line, but in the center of the track. And as soon as the jammer starts to pass them, either on the left or the right, they wind up just kind of collapsing in a circle around that jammer. So they're kind of waiting to see which way she's going to go. Voodoo slow to get up from the infield after that takeout, and she is definitely going to hand off the star now to her pivot. That's Poisonberry Pie, number 11, with the star in her hand.
Yeah, we've seen that pass a few times, but it just has not really been as successful as Houston would wish it to be, certainly. Santa Cruz definitely aware that that is going to be a potential, and they have kept eyes on it. They stretch that out just a little bit too far as the bridge starts to collapse. But as we've seen consistently over and over, Poisonberry Pie gets about half a track away, puts the cover on, the jam is called.
So this lead is actually now 36 points for Santa Cruz. And that wasn't an 18-point jam, of course, for Santa Cruz. My math was a little bit off in the previous one. So their lead had been 28 points. Now it's 36 points. But 145-109, under 5 minutes left. This is the largest lead either team has had in this game, and it is currently in Santa Cruz's favor.
Tara Ism, 116, taking that inside line. Soon as they do, though, we hear a whistle. That is going to send number 13 out for a multiplayer block inside of Santa Cruz, so she's got to go all the wide way around to the penalty box. Slayer Moon is jamming for Houston, caught at the back of the pack. Heartless Harpy was doing a nice bit of a job, though. We have now Santa Cruz's jammer for a forearm. Tara isn't going to the box.
So big opportunity for Houston. Number 91, Slayer Moon, lead jammer, also the only jammer. She's looking, she finds that open space on the inside. A Heartless Harpy tries to take her over the line.
You can see that frustration. She went, oh, and you know, the clenched fist and shake. But it was, again, credit to a beautiful job of Slayer Moon being able to stay on her skates, make sure she lifts the back ones so they don't go out of bounds and just swings around on those forward ones. 5-point pass on that one as well. Houston inching closer. Santa Cruz 145, Houston 119.
Had a couple of relatively simple scoring passes for Slayer Moon. Now is getting into some trouble here as she's got that triangle kind of looming over her. Tara is and has served that trip to the DerbySupply.net penalty box. That was her first, by the way. And that's a sure sign of why Santa Cruz has been in the lead situation that they are. 5 more points, though, do come in on the end of that jam for Houston. And now that lead is down to 21, 145 to 124. Less than 3 minutes remain, Ryan.
As we look at our score, it's been a consistent growth, but not, again, leaps and bounds. It's those little spurts. It was, you know, 13 for a while, and then it was 20 for a while. It just is kind of inching away, and it's hard to say that Santa Cruz is outplaying Houston because there's no real way that it looks like you can point to it other than points going up. Every time they score, Santa Cruz is just always getting, it seems, one more.
Brandy Brown with glue in her toe stop stays on the track, gets that lead status. We do have we do have Roasted Pony through as well on her initial, but a very quick scoring pass for Brandy Brown. And she's being told just to keep going. Trust your blockers to work on the recycling on Roasted Pony, which they do. So now she's up on another scoring pass.
Yeah, I think she needs to, especially you've got 2 minutes left in regulation play. You're down by 17 points, and the benefit staying in. Roasted Pony going for a high block. She's going to the penalty box right now. So power jam, Houston, 5-point pickup. It's going to bring them within 12 points now.
Brandy Brown,
wow,
very quickly around the outside as the Santa Cruz blockers get separated with Beans being left at the back. Brandy Brown comes in hard and a forearm penalty called for that collision on Brandy Brown.
Crowd not very happy with that. She was also kind of holding her cheek. Looks like she did make forceful contact, certainly enough to, as the referee saw, injure herself based on their perspective. So as we see now, 7 points, Santa Cruz in the lead, 145, with a minute and 7 left in regulation.
Star coming off, handed to the pivot, Shamrock and Roller. Back blocking penalty being issued to number 21 for Houston. That's Jekyll and Hyde, and that was the Jekyll side. Shamrock and Roller with the star on the helmet, though, puts up 5 points here for Santa Cruz. Brandy Brown being released from the DerbySupply.net penalty box. Both jammers coming through on scoring passes. There's 4 for Shamrock and Roller.
And that does pull us up to the end of that jam. We do have a timeout. That is Houston coming out.
Clock stopped, 33 seconds. And we have 13 points separating these two teams. And WFTDA would like to thank not only DerbySupply.net, but also Sin City Skates, 5-on-5 Magazine, and Something Inked.
So, Mr. Whistler, in this case, you're Houston. I think it's a good time to take a timeout. But what is the conversation that you would be having right now?
Well, I think looking over at who's already on that fast girl start line for Santa Cruz, I'm seeing Queen Litigious, who's got 63 points. She's been the most dangerous jammer for the team in black in this game. That conversation is definitely going to have to deal with not only slowing the pace down here, containing Queen Litigious, if possible, forcing that penalty and running with it. It is going to be a two-player deficit to start this one, because there are two skaters for Houston in the box. Of course, Houston going to counter with Bustin Beaver. They've put Betty Watchett out with the pivot stripe.
Yeah, interesting that they choose Bustin Beaver to jam. She's gotten 19 points, where Slayer Moon has come alive this second half, already at 43, came into the half with 4 or 7, but not nearly as many as she has gotten. So interesting play to put her in right now, as 20 seconds left on our jam clock, or excuse me, period clock. Looking to see which way they're going to go. Four wall straight across in turn number one, holding control, holding back Bustin Beaver. And it is indeed effective, as Queen Litigious is through. She's eye on the clock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because at this point, just has to wait for it to run down, and she does. 154 for Santa Cruz, 141 for Houston.
We do see Carl coming out. Carl Schultz not to be outdone by pretty much what everyone else has done, as the game's not over. I want to review something. And interesting when you consider there are 13 points. That is not certainly an insurmountable lead to overtake. So I could imagine why you'd want to have this conversation. But honestly, I'm not exactly sure what you would be reviewing at this point,
or what the possible outcome could be to your benefit. I mean, I've been in this situation too. I have some experience in my past as a bench manager as well. And sometimes you are going to make a call like this. You've got to show that you're fighting for your team. I know I've been there. I've done those. And sometimes you just hope lightning may strike.
You never know. I mean, if there's some sort of egregious action, the referee, the head referee in this case, Matt as faction, can decide that it is warranting another jam. It is possible. It is unlikely. It would have to be definitely something that would probably have a longer conversation than we just saw right there.
Matt as faction, just calling the captains and bench staff into the center just to complete this conversation. But if this holds, this will result in Santa Cruz. Hold on. No changes will be made. Call will stand. And that is going to put this one in the books. So Santa Cruz comes in as the number one seed, but leaves as the number three seed. They do go home with a medal at the conclusion of this weekend. Houston Roller Derby, though, still going to be quite happy with the fact that they have improved their standing at this tournament. They came in seeded number sixth. They opened the weekend with the rankings upset over Columbia.
Yeah, seed number three.
And so finishing in the fourth slot, that is going to be Houston's All-Stars. Final score, 154 for Santa Cruz, 141 for Houston.
The game coming up next is a bit of a pleasant surprise for a few people. We are going to have Demolition City Roller Derby coming in seed number 5, and Kansas City Roller Warriors coming in seed number 2, playing for the championship and second place titles. Now, both of those two teams are already guaranteed to go to Minnesota to our championship tournament in November, but you're looking really to see how you come into that number one, to see how it's going to mix up. So you got, bragging rights. You get a medal that says 1 on it instead of 2. But I think that especially Kansas City, historically one of the great teams, they've been in every playoff year since the inception of the WFTDA 10 years ago, which is a remarkable story in and of itself. Demolition City, though, coming a younger squad, trying to prove against the old masters we can hold our own. We definitely have a presence here this weekend.
Yeah, so this will be the first appearance in 3 years at Championship Weekend for Kansas City. Mm-hmm. Although in the Division II slot, as opposed to the Division I slot, Demolition City will be their first trip, of course. They are the darlings of the tournament if you want to look at the upset. I don't think anybody had predicted that they were going to wind up in this game. They've been a pleasant, fun surprise this weekend. Lots of energy, and that game coming up in about a half an hour time at 6 p.m. Eastern. That's going to definitely be an exciting one to watch.
Well, I think it's indicative of pretty much what we've had, particularly today, but this entire weekend, is Division II, very good gameplay. It seems to some people to be much more even matchups. We only had two that had more of a discrepancy of about 50 points. Otherwise, we've had, 10 points, 2 points, 1 point decisions. Fantastic roller derby here at the Division II playoffs in Cleveland, Ohio, at beautiful public auditorium. Has a very storied history, lovely place. We very much appreciate being here and having you join us here live, WFTDA.tv, at the 2015 International Playoffs. My name is Ryan Will. This is Mr. Whistler. It has been my privilege to be with him and to be with you here.